Tonight on This Week in Movies, new reviews of Megamind, Due Date, and more. We're chatting with King of Kong director Seth Gordon. He directed The King of Kong, everybody! And Farrell is going to go tumbling down the rabbit hole. All of that and more coming up in literally like 15 seconds on This Week in Movies.
Hi guys, welcome to This Week in Movies on the web at thisweekin.com/movies and on Twitter at TWI Movies. I'm Farrell Roth, and this is my dorky co-host in his Freakazoid t-shirt, Lon Harris.
She doesn't like my shirt. It's Calvin and Hobbes, but as dressed up as like Han and Chewie, and they're on a little Millennium Falcon. That's awesome.
You're a big dork.
Those are two awesome things that are awesome when put together.
You know what else would be awesome is if I was reading a little bit in the chat room. People are apparently somehow about me going to Catholic school, which I did. I think in the next few weeks, I am going to wear my Catholic school uniform from high school on the show.
Wow. I will continue to wear this shirt for the next 3-4 weeks until it needs to be washed.
How was your week?
It was good. Yeah, I watched a lot of movies, hung around, you know, a couple interviews looking for another job.
Did you read on my Twitter that I had a very long, extensive film conversation with one of my film heroes, Ed Burns?
I did read that, and you know.
It was...
I heard rumors about...
He's amazeballs, and I am a huge fan of his work. Not only that, though, I feel like, you know how Ashton Kutcher is sort of at the forefront of the social media wave and what's new? I think Ed Burns is really, at the forefront of what's going on with independent film. Mm-hmm. He explained to me in half an hour more things about marketing and how much money movies need to make in order to actually make any money. I didn't know what four-walling is. Do you know what four-walling is?
No.
It's when, if they're going to distribute a movie, like an independent movie, they rent out the entire theater for the whole weekend. So mm-hmm. He was saying, you know, some people go that route. But that costs like $300,000.
Wait, renting out theaters to show their movie.
Yeah, we're talking about like the whole distribution and what makes a successful film and how all these independent films are dying. Because he has a new movie called Nice Guy Johnny, and he's releasing it on demand. He's not putting it out in theaters. And he was explaining because, you know, there's just no way to really make money anymore releasing them. So he said, you know, one way that some people do independent movies is they do four-walling. So I would rent out, say, the Sunset 5 Theater, and they would only play my movie for that weekend. But it will cost me like $300,000. I just spit. Here we go.
But how would you make
any money? Exactly. Yeah. That theater is no way they're going to sell $300,000 worth of tickets for that weekend. So that's why these movies don't make money, because that's one way to do it. Or an independent movie could be in a theater for one weekend. You have to pay, you know, there's marketing. You have to pay to ship the prints. You have to pay, the theater takes a cut. So you just see why the independent cinema is dying. And doing something on demand, like the route that he's going, is a way to make some income. Why are you upset?
No, I'm fine.
No. So I thought it was very interesting. And so his movie is coming out that way. And he said a lot of his filmmaker friends are everyone is curious, does the model work? Because at least this way, everyone that rents the movie on demand, that money goes directly to him. He has no cost whatsoever outputting. Like, he doesn't have to pay to ship prints anywhere. It's just on demand. So anyway, I think this may be the future, watching independent movies in the comfort of your own home. And frankly, that's fine with me. I don't need to go to a theater to see everything.
That's the way things are moving anyway. The idea of going to a theater to see a movie is more going to become, I think, an event, is what people are saying. Whereas most movies you will watch just around your house.
Yeah. So he, of course, has a supermodel wife and children in New York, so he's not really here on weekends, but he says he would love to come to do the show. And so let's hope, fingers crossed, sometime in the next few months he will come on and talk about it.
That'd be great.
It was exciting. It was an exciting week. Did you go out over the weekend? Did you party it up?
No, I didn't. I went and saw a bunch of movies.
You didn't? Okay.
Because I got to do a show. I did an internet show.
I'm just trying to have a little chit chat. I'm so sorry. I'm still caught up in my night from last night, but that's fine. Let's move on. We actually have an awesome show because director Seth Gordon is here. Huge. King of Kong, Fistful of Quarters, as well as Four Christmases, and the new movie Freakonomics. And he has Horrible Bosses coming out, which I am really excited with. Jamie Foxx, Colin Farrell, and Jennifer Aniston, who rumor has it she's either very racy scenes or perhaps maybe gets naked. We will have Seth clarify for us.
Yes, of course.
So shall we move on for trailers?
Yeah, let's show the first trailer.
Let's do it.
So the first trailer we're going to talk about, it is from William Monahan, who wrote The Departed. He's the writer-director of this one. It's sort of a classic British gangster genre exercise. I'm a big fan of that kind of movie. It's called London Boulevard. Let's take a look.
Does he know about my sister? Everybody knows about your sister.
Listen, there are some people after me, and they might try and hurt you.
You're gone, man!
That will kill everybody, everyone who belongs to you.
I want you out of the country until I settle something.
Will you come with me?
Yeah, I will. Something I have to do first.
You best get out of London.
Don't worry about it.
You and me could be great. People will remember us.
You don't want me to be a gangster. Nobody wants me to be a gangster, because I could not stop if I started. You'd be the first to die.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know what to make of this trailer, because at first you're watching it, and it's like, well, this feels like a lot of other movies. I mean, there's, you know, Gangster Number One, and Sexy Beast, and all the Guy Ritchie ones, and then Layer Cake, and this has been sort of played, I feel like, the British gangster, tough guy genre thing. Having said that, by the time I got to the end, I was completely sold. You gotta love Ray Winstone in a movie like this. He looks like it's a really fun performance from him. David Thewlis, a great actor, pops up there for a little bit too. People know him from Big Lebowski, and he was in Naked, and a lot of other great movies. And even Keira Knightley, who I usually don't like, even she looks like she might be
Keira
fun in this one.
She might be fun. Yeah. She was super fun in The Bounty Hunter when she played the Bounty Hunter.
Yeah, Domino is terrible, and you
Domino
know
is good fun. There's people from 90210 in it. You gotta love it.
They actually
it.
Have to have words come up on screen to tell you what's happening. That's how, like, I am bored, and then, like, I am bored in text comes up on the screen. It's like, Tony Scott, please. Please stop.
Oh, it's another night of Lon being a hater.
I'm telling like it is. I'm cutting out the noise. Let's move on. Unless you have thoughts on Linda Boulevard.
No, I knew nothing about it. That's the first time I've seen the trailer. Yeah, I agree. At the same time, these genres may be sort of played out. This is, you know, what movie hasn't been made in some format at this point already? But I often see movies either A for the director, B for the cast at this point, and I think. Mm-hmm. Pretty stellar cast. So
great cast. I mean, the dialogue in Departed was so great. Mm. Monahan obviously has a feel for tough guy action crime sort of dialogue and that kind of world. I think it looks like a lot of fun. I'm definitely gonna see it.
Do you like my cherry shirt? Is more important.
Yes.
I thought you were gonna like say something about it. Got nothing. Nothing.
Nothing. Nothing for you this week.
Yeah, nothing. And I'm coordinated, as we love our favorite duo Will and Jada, and you don't even notice that. The red and the red.
The red, that's true. I don't have any blue on mine.
Oh, Lord.
You don't have any Calvin and Hobbes.
I do not, and do not expect that anytime soon.
Downside.
I'm going to talk about The Rabbit Hole. It's about the life of a happy couple is turned upside down after the death of their young son in an accident. It's based on the Tony Award-winning play by David Lindsay Abaire. It stars Nicole Kidman, Aaron Eckhart, and Diane Wiest. It's directed by John Cameron Mitchell, who also directed the movie version of Hedwig and the Angry Inch. Let's take a look.
I forget that he's not here sometimes. Like maybe he's just hiding under the bed. He's gonna pop out like he used to do. He's trying to make things nice.
You can't. All right, I'm sorry. Things aren't nice anymore.
Feels like maybe I don't feel badly enough for you. Maybe I'm not feeling enough.
Something's gotta change. I can't do this like this anymore. It's too hard.
Does it ever go away?
No.
At some point it becomes bearable.
Come on and get you over the collecting at the borderline.
space is infinite, then there are tons of yous out there, and there's tons of me's.
I like that thought. Somewhere out there, I'm having a good time.
Well, I saw this play on Broadway with Cynthia Nixon in Nicole Kidman's role, so my immediate thought was, interesting that they recast it, because easily Cynthia Nixon could have just played the role. She's quite good in the play. This is bleak. This is very depressing. You just have to know what you're getting in for. That said, I think I'm very curious to see Aaron Eckhart and Nicole Kidman together. I think that duo might work. It's a very sad, very good story. It worked as a play. I think it'll be a good film. I think already after seeing the trailer, I'm already stuck on Nicole Kidman's collagen plumped lips. And I know just from watching the trailer that that is going to distract me throughout the entire movie, unfortunately. And I know that that's terrible.
No,
but
I was going to say the same thing, that she's now had enough work done to where it's tough to believe her as like a suburban mom. You know, like you want to invest in her in that role because she's a good actress, but she's actually made herself look too Hollywood now, and it's tough.
I mean, if we didn't know what she looked like before, I guess we maybe wouldn't notice it. But I do. I mean, the first thing I thought was, oh my God, she had her lips done.
Yeah, no, she looks like she's had work done now, and like the woman in this particular story, it seems unlikely, would have had that kind of work done.
I agree.
It does take you out of it a little bit.
God, it's tough to be an actress. I'm telling you, it's hard. I think it's hard. But Cynthia Nixon, she won the Tony for it in 2006. It's one of those roles where I think Nicole Kidman actually will rise to the occasion, because I'm on the fence. I'm sort of hit and miss with her. But this is such a meaty role, and it's so emotional. And I think she relishes these kinds of characters, and I think she'll actually be excellent in it. It's just a matter of, do you want to go to the movies to see a movie that is going to really, really be depressing? And I think a lot of people don't really want to do that these days. But I will be seeing it, and I think John Cameron Mitchell is a great choice director-wise.
He's made some interesting movies. I mean, I think this has got to be the biggest production he's ever done, because Hedwig was his own play that he was adapting, very low budget.
Right.
And he did Short Bus, which was also pretty low budget. Mm-hmm. I feel like he's done one other movie that I'm blanking on. But this is definitely his biggest undertaking to date, so definitely curious about it. And it looks great. I mean, it looks grim, but it looks
yeah,
it looks
and
great.
What a stellar cast. Diane Wiest, I mean, the woman is just a knockout and everything, and she's great.
Fantastic.
You know, on stage as well as in movies. And HBO show, In Treatment, did you see her on that?
I don't watch In Treatment.
God, it's so good.
I know,
so good.
All
right, should we move on to In Theaters?
Let's do it.
Lots of movies tonight. Oh my, that is a graphic.
Yeah.
What year are we living in?
It's very 70s. I love it.
I feel like I'm on LSD. God.
All right. Well, maybe you are. I'll start it off tonight. I went and saw Megamind. I saw it on Friday afternoon, like a matinee.
With all the kiddies?
Yeah, all kiddies. Well, most of them are in school, except, you know, me. So it was a little weird experience that way, a little bit new for me. But, you know, it's fun. The animation is great. I think the biggest thing I could say for it is DreamWorks is clearly starting to put more after Monsters versus Aliens and now this. They're really starting to invest more, I think, time in, like, character design and the CG animation. It's more polished, it's funny, and it's really well done. And let's take a look at a clip in the trailer.
This November.
All right, put your hands in the air. Yeah! Metro City! And I love you, random citizen.
The battle between good and evil. Megamind will blow your mind.
This will be the last you ever hear of Roxanne Ritchie! Huh?
Don't panic, Roxy.
I'm not panicking.
I'm on my way.
Oh! I'm shaking in my custom baby seal leather boots.
Will Ferrell. Tina Fey.
Wow, that was really exciting.
Jonah Hill.
I'd be watching you like a dingo watches a human baby.
Mm.
And Brad Pitt.
That's right.
Your plans never work. You're so predictable.
You call this predictable?
Alligators, yes.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking about it on the way over.
Boom! In your face.
Juvenile.
So scary!
Seen it!
This thing behind this!
Tacky!
What's this one do?
Garish! The spider's new.
Spider? Yes. The spider. Even the smallest bite from Arachnus Deathicus will instantly paralyze. Ow! Get it off!
DreamWorks Megamind in 3D.
So yeah, I mean, the Shrek movies and Ants and some of the older DreamWorks stuff, it was all kind of bland. It all sort of melded together for me. They really didn't, I think, start to polish their animation until Kung Fu Panda and then beyond. This one is probably the most intricate, well-designed thing they've done so far. So I like that, especially the Minion character that David Cross voices. He's the fishbowl guy. It's weird and it's really ugly, and they're sort of not afraid to make it kind of an unpleasant character to look at because it suits the story and the comedy, which is really good. And the other thing I would say about it is it's pretty funny. The dialogue is pretty well done, and Will Ferrell as Megamind is funny. David Cross is good, and Tina Fey, she's playing an animated version of herself, but you know it still works. I had two major problems with it. The first one being that it does the Mission Impossible thing where a character is able to look like any other character he wants. Megamind has invented this watch that can transform him into pretty much anybody. He can take on the appearance of anyone.
Okay.
And when screenplays do that, it basically just takes you out of the movie because any character at any time could be anyone.
Right.
So you just kind of lose the narrative thread, and they way overdo it. Just like in Mission Impossible, how there's like 10 times a character takes off their face and it's,
right,
oh my God, it was a different character all along. Mm. That keeps happening in this. And it's like, it's impossible to follow a narrative like that because eventually things start happening and you're like, well
you don't even know if it's real. You lose interest.
Yeah, I mean,
huh?
That could be the bad guy, or it looks like this is happening. And you just feel jerked around. And so they do that a lot in this one, which does not work for me at all. And the other thing is, it feels like I've been down this road at this point too many times of it's a tongue-in-cheek romantic comedy in a superhero world.
Hmm.
And this one really feels like if you take some elements of Incredibles and you take some elements of Dr. Horrible, that's what you get. Then you have this movie. And we've seen this story now played out so many times in so many different genres that there's really just not that many more places to take it. I mean, it's clever, but it's like, yeah, okay, you know, he's a supervillain, and now he's sick of being evil. And, oh, okay, he's a supervillain, but he's in love with the girl who loves the good guy. And, I mean, you just, how many times can you see that? Or, you know, the Superman kind of character, but he's real smarmy and full of himself, and he's not really that likable. And
I feel like you're having, and I understand what you're saying, is, you know, this is a retread, and we've seen this all before, but I guess I keep coming back. I mean, you make movies, there's so many, how do you really not tread over the same territory to some degree?
Well, there's always going to be
all the time
common threads, but I mean, this exact take on this material.
Yeah.
Like, it's a superhero movie, but it's a tongue-in-cheek superhero movie. I mean, even that you could get away with a whole bunch of times.
Yeah.
And people have. There's Incredibles, and there's the Tick universe.
What was the one that recently came out with, I'm forgetting who it was, with Steve Carell? And it was an animated movie, and I felt like it was that same kind of thing where
Despicable Me.
Yeah,
right, that's
it's a little bit
like
that.
Like he's a
yeah.
supervillain. I mean, and I'm not saying, you know, filmmakers can't make the same kind of story many
I
times and
saying.
Take a fresh take on it, but I don't know how many fresh takes there are left on this particular specific concept of it's like, what if characters in comic books had normal, everyday human feelings like we all do? I mean, we've just, it's familiar now. And I mean, I'm sure young kids are going to go to this and the 3D is great and the animation is great and they're going to love it. And I enjoyed it on that level too. But you know, that's the only thing that's keeping me from saying it's like, it's great and Rush Out.
Megamind did not blow your mind.
Fair enough. If I was Gene Shalit, that's what it is. Like,
I give it one cherry.
Right.
Okay, should I move on?
Please.
To Welcome
let's
to the Rileys?
Move on.
Welcome to the Rileys. It's about a couple whose marriage is deteriorating since the death of their daughter 8 years ago until a stripper comes into their lives and breathes new life into their marriage. It stars Kristen Stewart, James Gandolfini, and Melissa Leo. It premiered at Sundance last year, and it's directed by Jake Scott. Let's take a look.
Meatball pub, way to go.
Thanks.
Here you go, babe.
I'm done. You work in a strip club.
How old are you? 15?
Listen, I think I'm going to stay here for a while.
What are you talking about?
I can't come home right now.
You going to sleep all day? Get moving.
Doug, I'm here.
You're in New Orleans. You look beautiful.
Oh. So basically, the story is set in motion when James Gandolfini's mistress in the film, who's a waitress at the diner, she dies. He goes to the cemetery and he sees that his wife, played by Melissa Leo, has already bought a plot for them next to their dead daughter. And he basically feels like he's living his life waiting to die. Their marriage is a wreck. The wife has become a shut-in. So he goes on a business trip to New Orleans where he encounters Kristen Stewart's character, who's a stripper, and he ends up moving into her house, deciding he's going to stay in New Orleans, and he pays her $100 a day to live there while he fixes up her house for her. There is no sex going on. It is strictly a father-daughter-esque kind of relationship, which clearly they both are craving at this point in their lives. And here's the thing. I really enjoyed a lot of the film because the chemistry between Kristen Stewart and James Gandolfini is so interesting. You keep wondering, are they going to end up having sex? And at the same time, you know they're not. They're both such good actors. It's interesting. That said, it's a very simple story. It's very predictable and obvious. However, I think Jake Scott did a really good job of tackling very, very weighty issues of abandonment, commitment, sort of shame, and he handles it with a lot of respect. Like, there's a lot of empathy for the characters. I really felt that this is a movie that has a ton of sensitivity and heart to it. There's a dearth, I don't know how to say this, but basically there is no nudity and there is no strip scene. And you cannot have a movie where the main character is a stripper and not have a strip scene. I saw an interview with Kristen Stewart. She said that they actually did film one and they cut it out of the film and that she was relieved that they did that. I'm sorry, but if you're playing a stripper and it's a big part of the storyline, you have to have a stripping scene. And if you shot it, it should have been in the movie. Then I wonder, maybe they didn't shoot it. I don't know. The thing is, I kept thinking of Marissa Tomei and The Wrestler, and she had plenty of strip scenes. It was artistically done. It was great. Stripper. There was nothing cheesy or scandalous about it. So that was a big glaring weakness for me. However,
I know who killed me, though. Classic film, and Lindsay Lohan plays a stripper.
Yes.
But she does not actually strip.
Well, she's on the pole a little bit. We're talking no pole action, no nothing.
No work
here.
In the pole at all?
No. No work in the pole. No. There is a lot of foul language. My mother would have serious issues with this movie because the cursing is outrageous, the language, it's very graphic, but there's no nudity. But the guys should not despair because, and I was clocking this for our male viewers, mm-hmm. there are a copious amounts of under the butt underwear panty shots of Kristen Stewart, where I'm saying the camera was almost down at her feet, shooting up into her butt, and she's wearing very skimpy underwear. Mm. So it's definitely an angle you haven't seen often on film, and there's numerous of this same shot of her ass, that's as racy as it gets.
Probably get a little look into Jake Scott's personal taste.
I don't know, it was
tastes,
a little
maybe.
Bizarre. There's a lot of hair acting. I'm not a big fan of this. Kristen Stewart has a tick, and I think that she's gotten better at it since the Twilight movies. She constantly is flipping her hair and tucking it behind her ear. That becomes frustrating. And Melissa Leo joined in on the action in this movie. Her hair starts off and it's all blow-dried straight because she's a shut-in and she's manicured at home and isolated. And then when she goes on the road in search of her husband, she's decided to cut loose. Her hair gets wild and crazy. And I cannot stand really obvious things like that. I know it's nitpicking, it's not a big deal, but that kind of thing is glaring to me in movies. There's some interesting cinematography, some beautiful cinematography. There's also a lot of very new director kinds of things, like unnecessary tracking shots. There's one shot where Melissa Leo takes a phone call in the kitchen, and the camera's sitting behind her head, and you just see the back of her head for the entire phone call. And I like artistic shots, but this just seems so unnecessary and random, and therefore bizarre, and that kind of annoyed me in the movie. Little things like that. Ally Sheedy pops up for one scene as Melissa Leo's sister. Again, I love Ally Sheedy, but for one scene, it just seemed to take you out of the movie. I didn't know that Jake Scott was Ridley Scott's son, and he was a music video director. This is his second feature. He did Plunkett and McLean. I'm very interested in seeing what he does next. I think this is a very good indie movie, but it had some glaring holes in it, and it seemed a little simple. I kept thinking, is this all there is going to be? But I enjoyed it. It's my kind of movie, and I am happy that Kristen Stewart is making these choices to do very offbeat indie films in between all the Twilight madness. The Yellow Handkerchief, The Runaways, which I thought was really underrated. I thought The Runaways was great. I thought she was great in it. And then she did a movie like this. So I think she's got a good team of managers behind her. I don't know if you would love this movie. I think Gandolfini is great, and if you're a fan of his work,
I was actually I tried to see it at Sundance. And I didn't get to that one.
He plays a guy from Indiana, and he has a southern accent that goes in and out throughout the film. That was the only thing I thought was bizarre, because he's such an actor's actor. I'm like, I'm sure there's a reason to this, but why is he talking with a southern accent when he's from Indiana, and then in some scenes he wasn't? But he has, which is sort of remarkable, lost the Tony Soprano. I mean, he's so identifiable.
He used to play a wide variety of characters before Tony Soprano.
I know, but I feel like no one really knows.
But you could go to, there were like a decade before The Sopranos when he played, you know, he was all over the map. So he's good.
I think this is the movie when it comes on DVD and you see it at home, you will enjoy it. And if you're a Kristen Stewart fan, she's great. She sinks her teeth into roles, I will tell you that.
Hey, vampire puns. Case. Love it. Love it.
All right, so we move on.
Let's move on.
I'm spitting and burping tonight, sorry.
All right, well, I'm going to give you a chance to do that off camera while we take a look at the trailer for the new Danny Boyle film, 127 Hours.
Love it!
Hey!
You lost? I'm a guide. What do you say?
So the guidebook says that the route's through here, and I know a better way.
All you have to remember is that everything will be okay.
Oh my God, Aaron!
Aaron! Yeah.
You liked him.
I don't think we figured in his day at all.
Kristen!
So I don't know how the chat room got on the topic of The Last Castle.
Because of Robert Redford, because of James Gandolfini.
It's because Gandolfini's in it. But of all the movies, I mean, True Romance, he's in that. Get Shorty.
The Mexican.
He's in lots of good movies. Yeah, that one is, Last Castle is a horrible, horrible movie. Shame on you guys for even bringing it up. Oh, it's really bad.
Oh, God.
So anyway, this movie is not really bad. This movie is really good. It's a real true life survivor story, which already I was like, it's a little less interested. And it's filled with crazy gimmicks all the time. Split screens, jump cuts, handheld video shots, computer generated sequences, extreme close-ups, dream sequences. And I mean, he's throwing all this stuff at you. And at first you're like, is he just trying to distract me? I mean, is this just like, there's not really much going on here and he's trying to like wave his hands around and make a lot of noise. But it all starts to make sense. And he actually demonstrates kind of a mastery of the pacing and the tone here. Like, the way he's calculating how to, like, turn up the energy and then turn it down to get, like, a maximum sort of reaction out of the audience is actually, it's pretty amazing, and it's really well pulled together. And it really does put you in this guy's mindset of being this, like, adrenaline junkie who then has to, like, slow down and stay calm and sort of plot a way out and try to survive in all these different ways. And you really do get in his head after a while. And I thought it was actually, like, surprisingly effective. And also, I thought it was interesting. It reminded me a lot in times of Trainspotting, which could not be a more different movie in terms of the topic. And yet, the way that film feels like these kind of sequences rather than a movie.
It's the energy, like, and the color and the bombardment.
It's a bunch of different, like, 5 to 10 minute films that come together and make this one story. And this film felt a lot like that to me, too. Mm-hmm. So you get, he's in, like, a romantic mood, and he's remembering, like, his girlfriend and all the people he's gonna miss. And so you get that little segment, and then there's, like, the, you know, survivalist, like, where he's plotting and rigging up pulleys and trying to survive. And there's all these different elements kind of mashed together, and it all blends together really well. And I was completely caught up with it. And the one other thing I want to bring up is Castaway. You remember that movie, the Tom Hanks movie that Robert Zemeckis
did? Which I think people, because of the one guy isolated for a whole movie.
And when I was watching that movie, I was thinking, you know what would have made this a lot better? Because I love the bits with him on the island, Tom Hanks. And I was like, you know what would have made this better is if you didn't see anything before he got to the island. If it just opens and there's a plane crash and suddenly Tom Hanks is on this island and you're spending the movie trying to figure out who this guy is. Like, here's what he's doing to survive, and then you're trying to go back and think.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well, like, without seeing the work for the parcel service and how he got there.
Let's just learn about his life by what's going on on the island. I think that would make Castaway more interesting, and this movie kind of, I think, proves me right, because it is very interesting in that exact way. You know very little about this guy.
Right.
And then he's pinned, and then you learn about him by what's going through his head while he's stuck there. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was actually really fascinating and really well done. And the flashbacks, I've read a lot of reviews that criticized them. I thought it was incredibly effective.
You've got to establish who he is a little bit. Otherwise, you've got to have some empathy for him. You want him to survive. And in order to want him to survive, you have to know a little bit about his life. Yeah. I thought James Franco was... really very good, particularly those scenes where, like, how many times can you watch someone, like, trying to push a rock, but when he was gritting his teeth and pushing, I mean, you just feel like, oh my God, like, he's gonna move it. He was so fully into it.
And it's gotta be hard to play a role like this, which is, it's so over the top. It's somebody pushed to the very extreme, and to not be over the top yourself. And he always felt, even when it's most outrageous or it's most disgusting or it's most
brutal. People ask all the time about the money shot, and I was saying it's actually not a shot. That's to me what was so graphic about it, because you're waiting and waiting for the scene where you know he cuts his arm off, is that it's not just one shot. It is a long, very bloody, gory scene. I mean, I don't know about you, but my theater, I watched most of it, but I had to cover my eyes. And I kept thinking, it's ketchup.
I watched
the
whole thing. There's two individual shots. It's about a 3.5-minute sequence, I'd say, from beginning to end of him cutting off his arm. And there's two specific shots. There's one involving a nerve ending, and there's one where it's just a bunch of, like, meat where it's all on camera. Those two shots, I think, are the ones. That's what's making people pass out. And if you can get through those two shots, you're pretty okay. And actually, it's
but if
pretty
you get
great.
Those, it's almost over. Like, if you get through those two shots, the movie's
but
almost
over.
But
it's very effective filmmaking. I mean, he just shows you enough to make it really stomach-turning, but without making it exploitative and over-the-top and like a horror movie.
I have a plot question for you, and maybe you'll have understood it.
Shoot.
I didn't understand when he stabs himself earlier on in the film, like with the knife. Why does it take him so long before? Like, I thought he was beginning to cut it then.
He hits bone and he realizes, because he thought, I think, maybe, like, oh, the bones have all shattered and I'll just be able to cut through. And then when he feels bone, he realizes, I would have to, like, don't mean to get too graphic on you all, I would have to break my own arm so that I could then cut through it.
That's
which
why.
Is what he eventually has to
And also, do. I thought the blade was so dull from chipping away at the rock that he couldn't use it, so how come all of a sudden it was sharp enough? Because I thought that was why they were trying to establish that the blade was too dull, but then it was obviously not dull
it
enough.
It was too dull to get through the bone. It all comes down to the bone.
But remember when he's trying to get through, he couldn't even get through his skin with it?
Yeah, but I think it also was, he didn't have the proper motivation at that point.
I thought maybe he found a different
knife. He needed
to
dig down, and I don't want to, there's a spoiler I could give, I'm not going to give it away, but there is something that, and at the very end, motivates him that had not been motivating him earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll know what I'm talking about.
I don't.
Well, we'll talk about it during the next clip.
Interesting. Okay. but I have to say, I don't really cry at anything. I teared up at the end of this movie, not because I was sad, but I was so overcome with emotion. So I agree with you. Really well done film.
Yeah, I thought it was great. Probably one of the better things I've seen this year.
Oscar nod for sure. Yes.
I mean, I don't know. I think it seems like it's going to do well. It had a really big weekend.
Yeah.
So I think if it does really well and it connects with audiences, yes. I think Franco's probably a shoe-in.
How much money did it make? Do you know? Over 20?
I don't remember, but it was on very limited screens. So
it had a really
good per-screen average.
Gotcha. Okay, well, moving on to Due Date. Exciting times. It's about an anal father-to-be played by Robert Downey Jr. who's forced to hitch a ride with a loser aspiring actor played by Zach Galifianakis after an airport altercation. The mismatched duo embark on a road trip from hell trying to get Robert Downey Jr. back to Los Angeles before the birth of his child. Let's take a look.
You're on the no-fly list.
We are having this baby on Friday. How do you expect to get home?
Hey, you want to ride with us?
Mm-hmm.
Crisis averted, I'm driving.
Say hi to her.
Do you have a hairdresser out west? I just got this killer perm and it needs some major upkeep.
So that's what I'm dealing with.
We're going to be traveling for a few days and it wouldn't hurt to get to know each other.
What's your favorite color? What age did you lose your virginity?
I was 9 years old.
Great gal.
Sheila Pimples.
We need to make a pit stop.
Close in 5 minutes. I got reservations at Chili's.
You have a reservation at Chili's.
That's actually smart. I mean, it gets busy on Wednesday night.
I despise who you are at a cellular level.
Okay, I've heard that before, and I'm trying to work on it.
I have never...
Well, Due Date was directed by Todd Phillips, who also did another road trip movie called Road Trip, which I have to say was a lot more fun because they're much more appealing, affable characters. My biggest issue with this film was there's no one to root for. These are two misanthropic characters. These are two guys that that don't even feel like real people. There are times when Zach Galifianakis seems like he might be mentally challenged. There's a very mean-spirited scene early on with Robert Downey Jr. slugging a little kid in the stomach. And so, and then at the towards the end of the film, there's a twist, which I thought was interesting because I wasn't expecting it, except the one character that you sort of feel bad for and you're, you know, he's the everyday guy, Zach Galifianakis, you kind of like him. He does something so horrible towards the end of the movie that you find out that you turn on him too. So at the end of the film, then they slap on this this fake sentimentality, like, oh, we want it to be a feel-good movie at the very end. And I'm like, now I don't like either of these characters. I don't care about either of them. And then I sort of resented the feel-good, you know, warm, cuddly ending. Yeah. There are some great scenes in the film in terms of all the misadventures that they get into along the way on the road. Some are really good. Some are very funny action sequences. But some are so over-the-top, redonkulous, that the movie loses credibility. So then you sort of give up on it. Like, I don't care. This would never happen. There is great chemistry between them in certain scenes. Robert Downey Jr. is just such a fantastic actor. His facial expressions, the way he delivers his lines, he's genius. And Zach Galifianakis is, I think, maybe aside from Jim Carrey, one of the most gifted physical comedians. He's so good with his body and what he does with certain scenes. That does not a good movie make. You need a good script. This feels to me like the studio was seizing on the success of The Hangover and just wanted to churn out another movie, put these two guys in it. And
I'm sure that's what happened.
You know, they're very talented. It's just that you keep feeling like this should be so much better. And if they'd given it a little more time or they'd had a better script, it would have been better.
I think it's interesting. You brought up like the Nebushi character. That's a really hard part to play. There's always that character in a movie like this, like Tommy Boy, you get David Spade, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, which I brought up as a obvious inspiration for this movie. You get Steve Martin, who's so great in that role in that film, because it's just on that line between being nebbishy and uptight, but not mean.
Right, like, and that's what Robert Downey Jr. is like, mean.
You sympathize with Steve Martin. For most of the movie, the audience is sympathizing with him. Imagine if you were on a road trip with this boorish, loud, obnoxious guy.
Right.
The audience has to sympathize with them at one point to find the fat, ridiculous guy funny. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, if the audience is sympathizing with the fat guy, they don't want to laugh at him the whole movie.
Or you feel like there are moments when you feel like he may be autistic or something. You feel like this is a little bit jarring. And then, like I said, there's this twist that makes him such a jerk, too.
You find out Anne Hathaway is dying?
But don't have me started on that movie. Don't have me started.
I'm shocked.
The thing I feel bad a little for with Todd Phillips, who I have to tell you I saw in person recently and is quite hot. I don't know why. I never thought that before, but kind of sexy. I feel a little bad for him because this due date and this whole publicity couple of weeks has been so overshadowed by all the controversy around Mel Gibson and The Hangover 2 because Todd Phillips is directing that. And apparently, reportedly, Robert Downey Jr. is the one that wanted Mel Gibson in The Hangover 2.
No, you mean Zach Galifianakis.
No. Robert Downey Jr. is the one that wanted Mel Gibson in the movie because he gave him a second chance by casting him in The Singing Detective after he got out of jail and no one would insure him and put him in a movie. And Mel Gibson gave him that shot and put him in The Singing Detective.
Robert Downey Jr.
wanted to return
because
he was making Due Date with Todd Phillips and Todd Phillips was making Hangover 2. Robert Downey Jr. is the one that suggested and wanted him to put Mel in the movie. Todd Phillips said yes.
Zach Galifianakis.
But they had made it. They whatever relationship Robert Downey Jr. had with... Don't look so defeated. Like I
I'm
did
not
read.
Defeated.
No, you're like, oh, I don't believe this.
Well,
no.
I'll be honest. I kind of don't see how that would make sense because Robert Downey Jr.
I know what you're saying, but I'm just saying these are the facts.
Okay.
But look it up. But you'll see. It is he who suggested it and wanted him, and what's made the publicity round for Due Date, and what they're saying that Robert Downey Jr. and Zach aren't even posing together, and there's all of this hostility between the two of them over the Mel Gibson thing that has nothing to do with their movie that they made, and poor Todd Phillips, who was directing both, who's trying to do publicity for Due Date, dealing with two actors that are now, you know, not getting along over something that has nothing to do with the film that they made together. It's kind of bad timing and sad. But it was interesting to me.
I think they're probably fighting over who's bogarting the stash. That seems more likely. That's a fight between those two.
I want to do an honorable mention because I saw Fair Game as well this weekend, which is the movie with Sean Penn and Naomi Watts about the CIA agent Valerie Plame, who was outed, and about the whole beginning of the Iraq War. This subject matter has been tackled before in Nothing But the Truth, the movie with directed by Rod Lurie with Kate Beckinsale, but it dealt with a different side of the issue. I could not believe how good Fair Game was. Doug Liman directed it. It is a nail-biting thriller. It is so well edited. It moves at a lightning pace. It is completely entertaining and utterly informative and educational at the same time. Sean Penn and Naomi, they're both at the top of their game. He's always good. She's sort of fine to me, but nothing spectacular.
She's been great.
She's so good in
she's
this.
She's been great and is capable of being great and is just not great in everything.
Right, maybe that's what it is.
A lot of things she may just feel tossed off to me, like, you know, The International with Clive
Owen. I know what you're saying,
well,
right.
Who's going to be great in
this
that?
This movie doesn't feel like it's that different from, like, The International, but she's so good in this.
But,
maybe
like,
she just needed to be
Drive,
directed. Yes,
fantastic.
She is.
Huckabee's.
You're right.
She's really great in that one. So she's been really good.
I understand what you're saying. My expectations were sort of media. There's not a whole lot of fanfare about this film. And I actually really like the Kate Beckinsale one where they're dealing with the other side with the reporter and her source.
Yeah.
And it's a whole different side of the issue.
Well, this one's actually based on Valerie Plame's own book.
Story. Right. Yeah. Exactly. And it's, between they go to Iraq and the breadth of the movie is much bigger, and I just tell you the pace, like my heart was pounding through the movie. It moves at such a lightning speed while it's telling you information and it's entertaining, and it's really as much about why we went to war in Iraq as about her personal story. And what surprised me is the ending is unbelievably patriotic and inspirational and satisfying, and considering the subject matter, which basically is saying we shouldn't have been going to war, the whole thing was a lie, we were lied to, all that stuff, then they still make you leave the theater believing, feeling really good about our country and our right and our duty and the way that they deal with the husband and wife's relationship. I was sort of blown away by this movie, more so because, you know me, I get so excited for certain movies and I get so let down when they don't live up to my expectations.
It's true.
This was a movie where I did not have any and I was so surprised. Doug Liman is, I know, a very good director, but some of his movies have not been that great, and this was like he's back at the top of his game. I was super excited about it. So I strongly recommend it if Megamind's not blowing your mind. So Tinchy, how are you? We see you. It looks like you got a haircut along with Lon. Am I wrong?
No, I did. Just a little bit. I usually like go 6 months between haircuts, and then once I do, I just cut it all off so I don't have to get another haircut for another 6 months.
I like it.
It's so weird.
Thanks. And I notice these small things even over Skype. I'm very shallow in that way.
Actually, I was kind of shocked too when you could see yourself in Skype when it popped up. I was like, "Whoa, yeah, that is short." I actually just got it cut today. That's why. So
it'll always look fine in a couple days. That's what my mother always says. It'll be fine in 2 days. Do you have some Hollywood headlines for us?
I sure do. So, putting together the kind of item list, sort of what was hot this week, I came upon the sort of joint theme that it's all about franchises, and that's not really surprising considering that's sort of what is fueling the current movie industry. But if you can't get enough of vampires, are you guys done with vampires yet? I can't get enough
of
it.
I've been
done with vampires for a while. And you know what I'm really done with is vampires and werewolves who don't like each other. Completely done with that.
It's never been done before.
And filmmakers that make movies in a genre that's already been there, done that. You're not into that. Retreads.
No.
Well, for those that are looking forward to more vampire movies, I have actually two big stories that are actually connected. They're two big vampire projects. Dark Shadows, which was a mid-1960s gothic soap opera on ABC, is a go. Johnny Depp will be starring as the vampire Barnabas Collins, with Tim Burton directing. And it's the screenplay is written by Seth Graham Smith, who is the writer of Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter.
Oh.
So there's a lot of vampire...
I just read a little bit about that. I'm like, I kept reading. I read the synopsis a couple times. I'm like, Abraham Lincoln and the vampire. I mean,
it's so weird. He didn't really die, and he's stunning vampires. And it's like that Pride and Prejudice and Zombies thing of historical horror gimmicky kind of stuff. Can Tim Burton please just like find some random funny script out there? Like
original funny script.
He's so much better when he's working with good, solid original material than these like endless, I'm going to redo like every fantasy thing that was big 20, 30 years ago. I mean, Dark Shadows, it's so campy. It's like if he was going to go 100% Ed Wood with it, I'd be excited. But I don't think that's what he's going to do. I think it's another one of these like reimagine this old, well-known property. And it's like, why? So much better when he's doing like Beetlejuice or something that is original and he can really make his own.
No, I totally agree. Yeah, I don't get it either. Yeah, he's just really been on this this remake kick. But yeah. Actually, out of all the ones that he's sort of remade or planned to remake, I think this one's kind of perfect for the two of them. It's
it always seems like, I mean, Alice in Wonderland seems perfect for him. Like, Willy Wonka seems really perfect for him, but it's like, but then he gets them and it's like, oh, there's really not that much to do aside from like burtoning it up. So now there's like black and white checkerboard floors and, you know, spirals
crazy
and
makeup,
like, you know, crazy snakes and everything. But like, it's still just the same story, and it doesn't give him room to just go crazy.
And you feel like, knowing his brain, he has original stories in there, so why is he not
but
telling
even if
his
they're
own?
Not his, just go... The thing that's frustrating to me is I'm sure there's a whole generation now of people like my age or a little younger who grew up with his movies, who are writing scripts that are Tim Burton-y just by nature of we grew up watching the Batman movies that he did and Beetlejuice and Nightmare Before Christmas. And it's like, I'm sure one of them has written some great original story in a Burton-type world that he could really go nuts with. And I mean, if you think about his movies, like the old ones, they're so idiosyncratic. It's like with the Calypso music and, you know, Alec Baldwin and Gina Davis dancing and then this creepy teenager and there's snakes everywhere and it's this little Connecticut town and it's so weird and so many different like elements that appeal to like him. And then he goes and makes like Willy Wonka and we all know what that's supposed to be and it just doesn't let him let loose and have fun with it.
No, I totally agree. I mean, you start with Planet of the Apes, and it just keeps going from there. So
yeah,
hopefully,
never as good.
Speaking of Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Hunter, we spoke before about in previous episodes about David O. Russell applying to direct with Natalie Portman. Obviously, that fell apart, and now it's being reported that Mike White has gotten the final offer. White is a prolific comedy writer. He's penned the scripts to Chuck and Buck, Freaks and Geeks, The School of Rock, and Nacho Libre. So he is not – they haven't said whether he's going to be writing and directing. Pretty sure he'll be writing. But the only thing that he's directed recently that he's written was The Year of the Dog with Molly Shannon. I didn't see it, but I really do love his work. So, I haven't read the book that this is based on either. So we'll see – I don't know what he can do with that material.
He's doing that Laura Dern HBO series called Enlightened, which is coming out, I think, just very shortly on HBO. He's super talented, but I missed, the beginning of it. What is he attached to direct?
Abraham Lincoln.
Oh, Vampire that Hunter? One, The Vampire.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yep. Year of the Dog, I saw. I very vaguely remember. It's really quirky, offbeat. Really quirky and offbeat.
Yeah,
so
that's his,
but she's talented.
Region is quirky and offbeat. He did The Good Girl, too, with Jennifer
But
Aniston.
That was much more
that's
mainstream.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was good.
Did you see Tinchy about Spider-Man 3? That was what I thought was exciting, about Sally Field maybe playing Aunt May and Martin Sheen playing Uncle Ben. I'm excited about that, right?
I'm not crazy about Sally Field,
honest,
but Martin Sheen, he's perfect as Uncle Ben. I mean, I can definitely see how he's going to step right into that role and wear like an old glove.
You don't like Norma Rae?
Sally Field has been, there are movies in which she works, and it's sort of like Martin Sheen that way.
Did
like,
you see Murphy's Romance?
Yeah, Murphy's Romance is a good movie.
She's
like, she's in good movies.
Real Places in the Heart.
I'm
going to go on my Sally Field.
Not crazy about that one, and Punchline is what ruins it for me. She's awful. That movie's awful.
All right.
I was annoyed by the aunt character in Sam Raimi's.
Me too! I don't know,
I agree.
Right? It was her dialogue, though. Like, she was so over the top.
She was the comic book. Like, that's all they really did. They didn't like try to add any twist to it. So comparing the two, I think Sally Field definitely is an interesting choice. To me, the most sort of, you know, bigger sort of news item in regards to Spider-Man reboot is the fact that Mary Jane Watson is rumored to be not appearing in this one.
Yeah, they're going the Gwen Stacy route in this
one, I guess. With Emma Stone. Yep. Hmm. So that's that was kind of surprising.
It's so weird they keep casting against hair color. They cast a blonde Kirsten Dunst as Mary Jane, who's iconically red-haired. And now they're casting
a
woman who's known as a redhead
as
Gwen Stacy, iconically blonde. It's interesting that they keep doing that. But Emma Stone, I think, a great choice for this kind of part and is going to be great. And I don't see how Andrew Garfield and Emma Stone could not have more chemistry than Tobey Maguire and Kirsten Dunst. Maybe the big screen couple of the last decade with the least amount of on-screen chemistry.
My God. Without a
doubt. Yeah, and I don't know if I blame either. I don't think Tobey Maguire really emanates a whole lot of sex appeal.
The two of them were just completely flat in all three of those movies. And I think, I don't love the first one. I hated the third one. I think Spider-Man 2 is actually a pretty defensible movie. But even so, that's every weakest scene is the two of them, and we're supposed to believe that there are sparks between these two people. And there just so clearly aren't. I mean, I could tell if they just hate each other off screen or Sam Raimi didn't spend enough time developing that plotline or what, but man, they are just, you don't believe for a second that he likes her, that she would ever go out with him. Mm. They're just completely
flat. You just count down the minutes till he puts on the Spider-Man suit.
Yeah, just like, please, yeah.
Any other news for us, Tinge?
In other superhero news, Zack Snyder, who has been signed on to direct the Superman reboot, will be in an interview with Empire. He spoke with David Goyer. With David Goyer, and he spoke to Empire about Goyer's script, which will not, according to Snyder, alter the DC Comics canon. So Snyder basically said it's a different story. He said there's no break in sort of the mythology of Superman, but there's definitely an approach they're both taking. He apologized for being vague, but he had to be. But he says that there is a way that they're going to get at sort of a fresh take on Superman. For those that don't know, David Goyer actually wrote the script for Batman Begins, and I believe had some help in The Dark Knight, although I think that was mostly written by...
He helped him out with the story, but he didn't write the script on Dark Knight.
So he has some, comic book cred. Going into this project. So Zack Snyder, not much cred with me, but we'll see what he can do. No green screens.
No, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. And last news item is another franchise. This one I have much more high hopes for, considering who is supposed to be involved. July brought worries of Daniel Craig and director Sam Mendes stepping away completely from their planned James Bond installment. Due to MGM's financial woes. But apparently the project was simply on hold. Yay!
Yeah.
Bloomberg is reporting that MGM plans to have Agent 007 back in theaters by November of 2012 and every 2 years after that, which is pretty aggressive. And also might be news to Daniel Craig, since he is right now starring in the remake trilogy with David Fincher directing the Millennium trilogy, a girl who kicked the hornet's nest,
the fire, the dragon kicked fire, tattoo, all that stuff.
So he's doing all three of those back to back. So
right.
We don't know if he'll be available. And actually, Entertainment Weekly predicted in this issue this week that the film won't be in theaters until at least 2014.
Sweet.
So
glad they're going to get to do another one, though. It would feel incomplete to end with Quantum Solace, considering how good Casino Royale was.
Oh, my God.
I can't believe in your news items you did not have the latest Miley Cyrus update.
Please.
That just happened today, though, right?
That she's going to be in this movie called So Undercover. We're playing a PI who goes undercover for the CIA at a sorority.
That's so Raven.
I'm so there. It's the same director that did... What Happens in Vegas.
Wow.
So, you know.
How did I miss that?
I'm there. I don't know. I was super excited about it. I also heard, did you hear that they were saying that the Beaver is going direct to DVD? According to inside sources.
In Europe, right? It's going to come out in Europe.
Yeah, and Summit says it's getting released in 2011 and they're standing by it. But there were sources that said that, sources close to Britain, that it's definitely going straight to DVD and that it's awful. Awful. But I don't know. I mean, these are just... And the poster I saw, it was kind of funny. Have you seen the poster?
Yeah, where it's a little beaver hole. He's holding up the little coat.
I think it's going to come out in theaters.
Gibson's face, which I thought was funny.
They put his face?
Yeah, they're purposefully hiding his face. And it's like, hey, this guy's crazy. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's obviously made with like a little nod to, hey, this guy's crazy.
That's smart marketing, don't you agree?
A little nod. Wow, it's just truth in advertising.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm going to see it either way, but I want them not to release it if it's not good. But if it's good, they should put it out anyway. I think people will probably be over the whole Mel thing by then.
No. Definitely not.
Okay.
Thank you, Tinch.
Thank you, Tinch.
Thanks, guys.
See you same time, same bat channel next week.
Sounds great. Later.
Toodles.
Should we bring in
Let's bring in our guest. Seth Gordon has directed the beloved classic hit King of Kong, Fistful of Quarters, as well as the mega-grossing Four Christmases with Reese Witherspoon and Vince Vaughn. Made lots and lots of money. Fun times, the movies. Let's take a look.
We just got to get through these four Christmases as quickly and as painlessly as possible.
Merry Christmas, Mom.
Hey, Dad.
Good to see you, Mom.
Merry Christmas, Dad.
Hey, these are my brothers, Denver and Dallas.
You must be Orlando's girl.
Orlando?
We're all named after the cities that we were conceived in.
That's disgusting.
Oh, my God.
Four families.
Bradley, I'm not trying to be your father. I'm hoping for a chance to be your friend.
Well, you were my friend. You were my best friend. But now you're sleeping with my mom, and it's a little bit weird for me.
One day.
That's you?
Mom, did you put that on the mantle?
I love that photo.
You look huge.
I ate my feelings, Brad.
She must have had a lot of bad feelings.
No mercy.
Jump, left me in the jump to die.
I thought you were waving at me like, hey, I'm getting past my fears. What would cross my mind over this to think that you could possibly be getting shanked by four-year-olds?
Hi, Seth.
Hey.
Thanks for coming in on a Sunday night. Lon, Seth has a new baby at home, and he came in on a Sunday night.
That's you're a good man.
Can you just tell us how you got your start? Like, what was your sort of first big break in the business in general?
Well, I had, my friend and I are running a graphics company, and we had assembled a reel over time that found its way to the desk of the Dixie Chicks manager at the right time. And we were doing these behind-the-scenes videos for them, and we happened to be along when Natalie Maines dropped the bomb on the president, and then stayed out to shoot what became that documentary, Shut Up and Sing. So my friend and I kind of, that was our first job, and then that led, in a way, to New York Doll, and then that to Kong, and then like that.
Like that. So was being a director in the back of your head from the beginning, was that your sort of your end-all goal?
Well, I think absolutely. You know, those clips that we were doing for the Chicks, you have to wear all the different hats, right? You have to shoot it and edit it and produce it and, you know, have a point of view the whole time. So that lends itself pretty naturally to directing. And we both, Luis and I, that was the guy I did that with, mm-hmm. We really enjoyed that opportunity, but I'd found, you know, the work that came after was no more demanding, really.
We just saw a little clip from Four Christmases, huge blockbuster hit. What is it like working with someone like Vince Vaughn, who strikes me, and I've heard, as someone that just does a ton of improv? Is it easy or extremely difficult to direct someone like Vince?
Well, coming from documentary, you never know exactly what's going to happen, right?
Uh-huh.
And you have to stay on your feet. And I'd say that lent itself to working with him in a big way. It was good.
I remember at the time when you guys were making Four Christmases, everyone was writing a lot about, Vince and Reese aren't getting along because they have such different approaches to their style of acting. What was that set like, and directing such a huge, big studio movie when you were coming off of a documentary background?
I mean, there's the sort of snarkosphere that surrounds movies is not kind to anything with Vince in it, for the most part.
Huh.
It was not nearly as combative as was reported. So that can distort how one thinks of what might have happened there. They were actually really great to me. They were kind in terms of giving me an opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And then they were... You know, they knew that I was making this big transition from, you know, guerrilla movie making, if you will, to, I guess, the big leagues. And so they were very aware of that, and they knew the sort of power that each of them wielded, and
right.
they were kind to me.
Is that frustrating for you as a director when there are reports like that, and that's what people are discussing and, you know, talking about? And does it affect at all the filmmaking process, or not really?
Not really. I mean, we were aware. We actually figured out who the person was on set generating the faulty rumors, and it was simply to make a little money. And once we figured out who it was, they were gone.
Interesting.
Yep.
So when you're the guy that comes from guerrilla filmmaking and then you go make a huge shoot of film, I was frankly flabbergasted to find out that you were the same guy.
Mm-hmm.
How did that happen? Like, did someone see King of Kong and they thought he should be directing a big studio movie
Vince,
that's like a romantic comedy?
Vince, because in creating Kong and finding a three-act structure in regular life, I guess,
mm-hmm.
I think that he saw potential there to shape any three-act structure and make the most of it and come at it from an original point of view.
Mm-hmm.
So that was where he came from, and I was lucky he had that position.
Did he call you up himself and say, I want you to direct this movie?
It was by way of the producer on Four Christmases at the time.
Uh-huh.
They, I guess, had talked about a number of different folks that might direct it. It was one of those films that went through a lot of development over years and years and years. In the current incarnation, they couldn't settle on a director. And I think, you know, sometimes in this town anyway, it can be easier to back someone who hasn't yet made a movie that people don't like than it is to pick someone with a lot of notches in their belt. You know, so that I think I benefited from being the newcomer in a big way.
Was there any reservation on your part in terms of doing a big movie like that? I mean, I can imagine getting that phone call and thinking, are you sure, like, I'm this guy? Like, you want, and did you ever think of saying no, or that's not my genre?
I debated it a bit, and I had, you know, but any of my friends, the people I trust in my life who I spoke to were like, man, you gotta, come on,
yeah.
Right? Try it.
Come on.
See what it is, so.
What kind of director are you on set? Are you the Woody Allen-esque type where you don't really say a lot, or do you get in there and do a lot of direction?
Well, in making documentaries, and being a guy who stayed in dark rooms with fluorescent lights editing a lot, I wasn't used to communicating and getting out in front of people and getting my point of view across, because it was, so much was built after the fact, you know, in documentary. And so that's been the journey for me, is getting, you know, finding the right way to articulate things and or even figuring out what way we'll get that message across, you know? And so that's been my journey, is increasingly communicative, going from the sort of hermit to at least...
I'll send her a note, like, in the study hall. Like, please try that a little funnier.
Exactly, you know.
Interesting. Well, let's take a quick look at King of Kong so we can get into discussing that film. Or maybe not.
Well, we do have a clip.
We'll chat for a second.
We do have a King of Kong clip we'll throw to it.
Well, Donkey Kong, without question, is the hardest game.
That's a tough machine. People think that the machine is possessed.
The average Donkey Kong game doesn't last a minute. It's absolute brutality.
The mysterious player from the West Coast, Steve Weeb, is here.
He could beat it if he'd have to have a really good game.
You want to put a score up, you're competing against everybody in the world.
It's not even about Donkey Kong anymore.
He's a very devious person. He works things out to his ends very well.
Well, Billy Mitchell always has a plan.
World Record Headquarters, can I help you?
Well, maybe they'd like it if I lose. I gotta try losing sometime.
No matter what I say.
Seth, I'm just so curious. Did you want to make a movie about this and you went in search of these two guys, or did you somehow meet these guys and decide, I have to make this documentary about these people?
It was a sloppier evolution than that, even. I'd been going to that arcade since I was a kid, which is Fun Spot, which is now the Budokan of video games in New Hampshire. Huh. And it only has survived because the owners of that place, they just never went out of business, and all the other arcades did, and then they got all the games. And then because they had all the games, that's where all the best went to play, and it just evolved to this place that has a wall of fame and everything. And for me, literally, I don't know if it's clear on camera, but I'm pale, and so I burn at the beach. And when our folks went to New Hampshire in the summer, they'd put me at Fun Spot, where I love to go. It's like my Disneyland. And I just remember that place through the years. During college, would make pilgrimages up there and, you know, get a chance to play. It was a real treat.
Were you in college in New Hampshire?
No, but not far. And so we could drive there and make a
weekend. Well, you made a trek. This is a serious mystery. Okay, got it.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway.
What did you play when you went?
I love Karate Champ, actually, which, you know, full point. I love that game. There's a bunch of, when you're there, it's also, it's really nostalgic, because it's just row after row of all the games that have never been in the same room for you know, which is like, you know, it's 7-Eleven in Chicago had this one Pac-Man and
every
whatever.
Every place would have two machines. Right, you'd find out where the machines like, you
that's
liked
it.
Were.
300. And is it just the quarter? Like, you still just pay what you would have paid back then?
Yeah.
Huh.
So I love that place. And then my friend, Ed Cunningham, with whom I'd made New York Doll with another friend of ours, he met Steve Wiebe. And I saw an opportunity on the horizon to go back to Fun Spot. And that's literally why I said yes. And then we met Billy. And then we
said, you weren't searching for like a Billy character.
Not at all. Okay. We actually, what we thought we would do, because we all liked Spellbound, that great doc.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We said, let's make a video game rivalry doc, and we'll just, because each of these titles has a couple, three people that are the best. There's, you know, a few guys that can really play Ms. Pac-Man all the way to the kill screen.
Oh, so different, you do it over different games.
Yes.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay.
So, and gotta get Mr. Awesome in there.
Exactly. Missile Command. So we pushed into the stories around each of the interesting titles of the ones we liked best. And then Billy had like a bunch of the titles. And when we, at some point, he held a lot of records. So we went to meet him and we asked him, you know, just about all of it, because we're just researching. And when we got to Kong, he wouldn't say the name of the guy that had the title at present. And he like avoided it. And it was almost like he was rewriting history or avoiding him in the history. And since he is the writer of the history books in many ways, we thought, that's weird. That's weird. And we had met Wiebe by that time, and we were like, something's interesting here. But we kept, you know, watching that whole world and tracking some of the stories, but then Billy's actions and shenanigans and kind of, you know, behavior, which none of us could have predicted, became the movie because it was so sort of diabolical and and thought out and like elaborate. And
so you were following them with cameras at this point. Like you had already decided to like make it about just the Donkey Kong and these two guys. And they were each aware that you were filming the other person.
Yeah, they were, that whole world knew that we were making this movie. Mm-hmm. They didn't know really what it was, but we didn't either. I mean, we were trying to figure it out as we went, as a good documentary should. We didn't know the outcome, but then Billy became the most interesting thing, and how different Billy was from Steve became even more interesting, and then what he did to stop him, and la la, it was just great.
Yeah, it really builds like a fictional
story. Such tension,
story.
Yeah.
Yeah. One of the things, because I rewatched the movie recently for the show, and you notice all of these different sort of characters in that world that you're interviewing. How hard was it to get stuff out of these people? Did they all really want to talk to you, like Walter, the sort of referee, and all these other guys were in sort of Billy's orbit?
Yeah.
Did they have these stories that they couldn't wait to tell, or was it a little bit more about teasing out their sort of personality?
I mean, in the case of Walter, I think he, of that whole group, is the showman.
Right.
He has all the great speeches, and he really has a great heart, too. I mean, he's inspired a lot of these guys to invest time in becoming the best at their particular niche game. So for Walter, it was just a matter of asking him pertinent questions about the science and craft of mastering anything. And he's got this transcendental meditation background.
Yeah.
So he comes at it with this philosophical language that's really inspiring. So that, not him so much. Merkcheck, on the other hand, who's sort of, in a way, has the most rigid rules and
yeah, he's
and
the
backbone.
Guy who's actually watching the tapes and confirming scores.
And
yeah.
I was the lead referee at the time. He had sort of there was certain things he was willing to say and not talk about, and like there are rules and right and wrong, and I found him really fascinating in his own way. So everybody in that world are different. Some of the people, I think part of what you're getting at is that some of the folks just aren't.
Your image of gamers is that they're these guys that live in their mother's basements and they're not socially awkward. But
some of these guys are that. It's not all of them, but some of them.
A couple.
Fairly eloquent and passionate.
They're all eloquent, actually, but definitely nervous in front of the camera, some of them. But a lot of them have families and kids. What's interesting, you talk to their families, and each of the families thinks all the other guys are the weird ones. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But not their guy. Not
their guy. Were you surprised that this became as big of a hit as it did, and that it crossed over? I mean, someone like, I've played maybe one video game my whole life. I mean, that I really enjoyed it and got so much out of it. Or was that your intention, that because of the story and the nature of it, it doesn't have to be? Because I just thought it was going to be about video games, and it really, as I saw, was not. But were you surprised that it did as well and that as many people took to it as they did?
Yeah, we thought we were crazy for making this movie and for continuing to make the movie.
Did it take a long time to make?
Years. It
years,
took years.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, and it was start and stop and not constant, but it was a whole lot of time to be spending speculatively on something that was, you know, at best a weird video that a few people would see, and that's what we thought. And it was, you know, we put it down for 6 months. We went to Fun Spot. We shot what eventually would be Act Two, but at that time it was just confusing and delirious. We were all delirious, like, what have we just witnessed, and what is this? I can't work on this anymore. And we put it down for a while because we literally thought we just wasted all our time, and Billy wasn't even there, right?
Yeah. Hmm.
But we had sent a cameraman to his house in Miami, and didn't even know what that guy had shot. And it was the assistant editor who was logging footage while we were all sort of taking time away, while he caught up through all the tapes, and he said, we have two sides of one phone call, and it's incredibly important to the movie, right? And we hadn't realized what we had accidentally captured, and then we were able to cut that phone call together, and that kind of turned the tables on the whole story.
Interesting. Well, I want to talk a little bit briefly about Freakonomics, which is on demand now. You directed a segment in this documentary. I think we have a clip that we can show.
What's not clear is why.
The line between, like, economist and criminal is incredibly thin.
And what about journalists?
No line.
Oh, that is so cool!
You give people permission to challenge conventional wisdom and to ask a different kind of question entirely. Total BS, wasn't it?
How did you get involved in, I mean, again, another documentary, so I'm not surprised you're involved, but yeah. What made you want to be part of this film?
Well, the lead producer, Chad Trotwine, had gotten rights to the book, and my folks taught economics and social science, sort of broadly defined, growing up. So this content and this concept was not, you know, far from home. At least it was part of dinner table conversation growing up, you know. So for me, when he said, would I be interested or asked, I jumped on it immediately. And I just wanted to figure out how best to be part of it. And he had this great idea to have a group of directors, sort of the current, you know, representing the current voices of documentary, if you will, do the different chapters from the book, because the chapters are so diverse in the book itself. So we attacked it and tried to find, you know, the most interesting voices for each of those pieces, and I think it came out pretty interesting.
It's such a, I'm surprised in a way that it hasn't been done before, because they've had a few movies, was it I Love Paris, or, you know, the few directors
Paris
all tackling,
Jatem,
you know, tackling love stories or something, so this, and documentaries of all, where it is, you know, usually a topic, the idea of bringing in a bunch of directors to do different, I mean, it makes such sense. I'm surprised we haven't seen
just
this
just a documentary
before.
About a like a best-selling nonfiction economics
right.
book.
Yeah,
it's,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's just sort of unique to itself to begin with. Yeah.
I want to ask you a little bit about the upcoming Horrible Bosses. So excited about this movie. What can you tell us? Because I've read lots of things, but they're all on the blogs. We hear Jennifer Aniston gets naked. She has very racy scenes.
She
I know Colin Farrell has a comb over because I saw a picture. What can you tell us?
Well, it'll be out this coming summer.
Is Jennifer Aniston naked? A little bit.
I'm not going to say. I shouldn't say one way or the other about how she gets. I'm not trying to be overly coy, you know. We're still editing the movie.
She doesn't want to make promises.
Don't want to
right,
make promises,
there we go.
But she does great work. How about that?
That I believe. What is it like for you in terms of doing a film like a documentary, like a King of Kong versus these big studio films? I mean, I know the catering is different. I know your trailer is probably different. But do you have a preference? And are you a different guy when you, or have you found, like, looking at yourself, are you a different type of guy when you're making these two very, very different kinds of films?
Yeah, I mean, I think it calls on different skills. I think in documentary, I have to wear a whole lot of hats. And when it comes to the narrative filmmaking, there's a very specific job function that I have to serve that's very focused, and it is sort of important to delegate everything away so you can do that job and that job only. So that's been an interesting thing to balance. But I think of the two disciplines as each other's antidote, because they really do balance each other out.
You have an interesting cast you've assembled for Horrible Bosses, Jamie Foxx and Colin Farrell. Did you have a Are you a guy that cares a lot about the casting? Like, is that very, very important to you and landing those specific people for these roles?
Yeah, I mean, like anybody, I think watching big movies, it's hard when performances don't ring true to sit in the audience and not be irritated at that. So we spent a lot of time thinking about the casting and talking to folks and figuring out who would we want to see in these antagonistic roles, you know? And Spacey's one of them, and I think he plays sort of straight to his bullseye, which we all, I think, love to watch and haven't seen in a while.
Yeah.
And Colin, I think, is this incredible comedian that hasn't been given a chance often to show that skill. I thought he was incredible in Bruges. He was just
so
incredible.
Good.
And
Ondine. Did you see Ondine?
No, I didn't see
So that. Good.
Yeah, he's really something. And I want to give...
He's very underrated, I think.
Yeah.
Get that sort of pretty boy kind of persona to him.
Had this interest in uglying up a little.
Well, he has the felt with the Tom Cruise. That's all I thought of when I saw the hair.
He's like a new world. He's great. And in Bruges, he's great.
Yeah.
He's been good in a lot of movies. Cassandra's Dream.
Directing a studio film, being a new father, which is a harder task for
new
you.
New father, although my wife would tell you that I don't do that as much as she has to, she watches the kid more than I've had to because of the movie. But anyway, I'd say being a new dad is the best in all departments.
In all departments. I read that maybe your next project is something called Mixtape. Is that true?
I love that script. I would love to make it,
Is it about a mixtape? That's all I'm thinking of is high school and getting mixtapes from boys.
Yeah. It's about a girl who's growing up now who finds a mixtape that her father had made for her mother. Her parents had passed away. And she literally is like, what is this object? Like, cassette tapes just for 13-year-olds, they don't know what they are. So she finds that and a Walkman, which eats the tape immediately. And so all she has is this sort of playlist written on the jacket. Mm-hmm. Most of the songs can't be found on iTunes or anywhere. And it's about this little girl who's grown up kind of sheltered, getting out into the world to kind of figure some things out.
Oh, I like it. I feel like I'm seeing Emma Stone, but I think that's just because we've been talking about her so much.
13.
I guess so.
Emma Fanning.
Oh, right. Yes, possibly.
Yeah.
Is there anyone I feel like you could basically make a movie with whoever you want right now at this point in your career, but is there anyone you're really dying to work with at this point?
Oh, there's so many good actresses and actors, out there.
Mm-hmm.
The girl who will be playing that role, assuming we're able to get it all together, is Chloe Moretz.
Oh.
So she's really something. I think she'd be fun to work with. And Let Me In.
Right.
Yeah,
based
which
on
I really liked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
All right. Any other questions? You want to throw them out?
No, I think we got to wrap it up.
We're good? We got to wrap it up. Well, I want to thank you so much for coming in on a Sunday night. Please thank your wife for us. I know letting you out on a Sunday night with a new baby at home. She is my new best friend. Check out Freakonomics on demand now if you have not already. And next week, our guest will be documentary filmmaker Stephanie Suchtig. She did a documentary called Tapped about the bottled water industry. And she will be here next Sunday night. I hope everyone has a glorious week and that you join us again next Sunday night right here. That's a wrap. Toodles.